Hello, welcome to my talk. My name is Franziska Hess. I'm currently a junior professor at the TU Berlin. And my research is concerned with the computational study of catalyst materials and catalytic reactions. And a fairly new application of computational techniques in catalysis is the discovery of new catalyst materials, which I'm going to tell you a little bit about in my talk. Now, obviously, there are many different kinds of catalysts. However, all of these catalysts have a few things in common, a few basic properties that all of them must have. So first of all, of course, we want our catalyst material to be highly active so that we can achieve a high conversion, convert a lot of our reactants into useful products. But also a catalyst must have a high selectivity, which means we want to make specific products, not just any products, but very specific ones. And we want to prevent the formation of waste that we can't use for anything. And the third important property is that the catalyst must be highly stable under reaction conditions so that it will last for a long time before it needs to be replaced. If we want to identify new catalyst materials, we need to connect the catalyst activity with fundamental catalyst material properties, as shown here. So we have material properties, and we want to make deductions about the catalyst activity from these material properties. This connection is usually not immediately obvious, but rather we need a computational model that is able to connect the material properties with the catalyst activity. And such models are usually built based on previous insight, using experiments or more detailed computations, or, which is the most common scenario, a combination of the two. So what we actually need for reactions under harsh conditions is a model that is able to predict catalyst stability rather than catalytic activity. And predicting catalyst stability is highly challenging, which has two main reasons. So the first reason is that catalyst degradation happens on very long timescales, and these timescales are usually not accessible directly by current computational methods, which means we need to develop new computational methods to model catalyst stability. And the second reason is that there are many possible mechanisms by which catalysts can degrade under reaction conditions. And I just want to show you an example of a few different degradation mechanisms. Here on the right side, you can see a model of a supported catalyst. We have here a metal nanoparticle and here a catalyst support, which has a pore right here, and there is gas flowing through the pore, and when the gas gets in contact with the catalyst, a catalytic reaction can happen. Now, what can happen? This metal particle has a quite round shape, which means that the surfaces of the particle are not very stable, but they are highly catalytically active. However, under reaction conditions, especially under high reaction temperatures, the particle can reshape and form more stable surfaces, but these surfaces will then be less catalytically active. This will lead to a decrease of the catalytic activity. Catalyst poisoning means that unreactive substances can adsorb on the catalyst surface and block the sites, which prevents the catalytic reaction on the surfaces. A catalyst can also undergo chemical reactions with the reaction medium, forming new phases, which are then catalytically inactive. Chemical reactions can also lead to the formation of volatile compounds, which leads to irreversible loss of the metal catalyst in the system. Now, the last mechanism happens when the catalyst has a poor selectivity and forms some solid byproduct, which will then accumulate inside the catalyst pore, which will then block the gas flow into the pore and will also block the contact between the gas phase and the catalyst. So you can see that there are many different degradation mechanisms, and which ones of these actually happen in your catalyst depends on the reaction and also depends on the catalyst and on the reaction conditions. So I have brought you an example from my own research, which I am currently doing here at the TU Berlin. And this research is concerned with the so-called Deacon reaction, that is the oxidation of hydrogen chloride with oxygen to form water and chlorine. And for this reaction, we usually use a metal oxide as a catalyst. And this catalyst can undergo two different degradation mechanisms. The first is catalyst chlorination, which basically happens when the catalyst reacts with the reaction medium, which is hydrogen chloride, and forms a metal chloride. This process is usually irreversible and will lead to a loss of the catalytic activity. And the second degradation process is the sublimation of this metal chloride, which will lead to a permanent loss of the metal inside the catalyst bed. Because the reaction conditions are so harsh, the catalyst degradation is actually a major bottleneck in the practical implementation of the Deakin process on a large scale. So this is actually a very good example to develop a model that is able to predict new stable catalysts. And since we have two different degradation mechanisms, we need to take both of them into account in our modeling. So we use a so-called descriptor-based method, which means we have some materials properties that determine whether or not our catalyst can undergo these two reactions. And that's basically just a number, and this number indicates how prone the catalyst is towards one of these degradation mechanisms. And the model uses only very fundamental properties of the materials, which means that we can actually apply this model to a large number of different compounds in the periodic table. So here's an overview of the elements whose compounds I have studied in the context of this reaction. So you can see that I actually used a lot of elements, which is possible because it's such a simple kind of model. And because the descriptor is just a number, we can actually display the result also in this periodic table. And I color-coded the result, and red means bad and blue means good. So we have a few materials that are, in this case, I'm looking at the chlorination descriptor. Here we can see we have a few materials that are not at all prone to catalyst chlorination, while some others are extremely prone to catalyst chlorination. And some of them are kind of in between here, this whole area, this would be kind of okay, and all of this. However, we have a second property, and that's the volatility, which we can also calculate and graphically display in this way. And also here, again, red means bad and blue means good. So now here we can see that all of these materials, they are not volatile at all. However, here some of these materials are now volatile. And what we basically need to do now is we need to take the materials which are blue for both of these criteria. And in the end, we come up with this very small selection of catalyst materials. However, just the stability is, of course, not sufficient because the catalyst must also be catalytically active to catalyze the reaction, obviously. And some of these materials are actually already known in the context of the Deakin reaction, like aluminum and silicon dioxide. They're actually used as catalyst support materials in the reaction, which means they are indeed very stable, but they're not catalytically active. So we can actually rule out these materials as catalysts because we already know that they are not active, but they're stable. So that's already a very good confirmation of our computational model. Now, thorium and uranium are radioactive, so using them in a large-scale process would be a major safety concern, so we are also going to rule out these two candidates. So in the end, we end up with just these five candidates, and among these, I'm going to rule out scandium and rhenium as well because they're extremely expensive and quite rare and actually not suitable for large-scale processes. So in the end, we end up with just three new candidates, which looks a little bit disappointing on first glance because we made all of this effort and now we find out, okay, there are only three new candidates. However, this result is actually very important because it confirms what has been suspected for a long time, and that is amongst the binary oxides means MOX, you have one metal cation and oxygen in the lattice. Amongst the binary oxides, there's most likely no suitable catalyst material. And this is actually a very, very important insight, which also tells us now what we have to do in the future. And that is we need to study more complex compositions, that is ternary oxides. Ternary oxides contain two different metal cations and oxygen. And this is basically also the direction that I want to take the research into. I'm going to expand this model for ternary oxides and perhaps even more complex compositions and see if we can find suitable candidates in this much larger chemical space. So for the ternary oxides, the chemical space is actually much larger than for the ternary oxides because now we have two different metal cations. And now if you imagine you have 60 elements, and you need to write down all of the possible combinations of these 66 elements, you will end up with a very large number of compounds. And this highlights actually the particular strength of this method, because this modeling approach uses only fundamental and relatively easy to calculate data. So we can actually apply it to hundreds of different compounds if we want to. So the take-home message for this is that computational modeling can be used with great success to identify new catalyst materials. And catalyst degradation is an often overlooked problem that has not been studied with computational methods at all in the past because it's so highly challenging. However, we can develop new models that are able to actually predict catalyst stability and apply these models to complex compositions. And with that, I would like to thank you for your attention, and I wish you a very pleasant day. Thank you.